there, Enthusiacs. Welcome to a special Hero Talk Minisode. I am your host, Judge Greg. Joining me today, the Black Dragon himself, executive editor, Enthusiacs.com, Vernon. Vernon, how's it going?
Pretty darn good. How about yourself?
I am amazing. This is our Superbowl episode because literally just minutes ago, Superbowl 51 just ended. And for those who don't follow me on Twitter and wouldn't otherwise know, I am something of a New England Patriots fan.
No way.
Yes. So I had various different shifts in mood over the course of the night. Went from excited to suicidal homicidal to apprehensive to heart-stopping to elation and ecstatic. And I can't even put into words. And you were all like, so are we going to do this? And I'm like, just give me a minute.
I need a minute to decompress.
Yeah. So, I mean, I know you're not like really big on football, but I know you were an Atlanta fan. So I just, to you and the 90% of the world who was on Atlanta's side in this one, I'm sorry, but.
To clarify, I you know what? I'm mainly for the Broncos sometimes, but I didn't grow up with sports, and just seeing that the Patriots were in the Super Bowl this year, I'm like, I gotta root against them, number one, because I live in New England, and I'm originally from New Jersey, and all I hear is Patriots. Bruins, Celtics.
Celtics.
So
yeah.
I'm tired of hearing about all these teams. I'd never heard about like the Giants or the Jets, you know, this much when I was in New Jersey, and now it's constant, just a constant barrage of Patriots. Like there's the Belichick, I guess, do your job memes all over my workplace. So I am just so tired of seeing that stuff. So I root against the Patriots just on principle. I'm just like, you know, if they whipped it out and just started like, you know, having that energy from the beginning of the game, I might feel a little bit differently, but I'm just like, nope. They're not bringing it. They're not bringing their A game. It's like the Broncos a couple of years ago when they fumbled that first snap.
Oh, man, that was – yeah. I remember –
it was downhill from there.
Yes. I remember I was really actually pushing for the Broncos that game. And it was so painful to watch as they just kind of fell apart and imploded on themselves on the football field. And I thought of that game too, because I thought I was watching that again, except now it was a team I was emotionally invested in.
Yeah.
So I mean, when you get to halftime and it's 21-3, I remember thinking, okay, well, I mean, at least now I can start watching the commercials, because there's no way this game's coming back.
And they brought it back.
Yeah, the third quarter was pretty ugly, so I felt pretty confident. And then all of a sudden, fourth quarter, Tom Brady just kind of wakes up and looks at me and goes, hey, wait a minute, I'm Tom Brady. And then he starts completing passes again. And then the defense suddenly wakes up and is like, oh, are we supposed to be protecting the quarterback? And then they start doing that. I mean...
Yeah.
It was a totally different game. All of a sudden, Tom Brady could make throws and receivers could catch them, and it's like they it's honestly like they woke up. I'm wondering if Belichick was like on the sideline sacrificing a chicken to some, you know, to the football gods, saying, you know, I pledge you my firstborn son if we can come back and win this one.
I mean, are they like the first time a team has won more than what, four?
I know Tom Brady, in terms of just the quarterback, has now won more than anyone else. And I know that as a franchise, they've been to more, but I actually can't completely vouch for wins. So
I am tired of hearing about Brady. His team won. It wasn't, you know, it's not just... you know what?
He did his best to lose that game for him.
All the cameras, like, surrounded him, and his team had to, like, push through to give him a hug and stuff. And I'm like, all right, let's focus on the team, because they actually, you know, did a lot of the work, too.
I hear that. Tom Brady gets a lot of criticism, and he earns about 99.9% of it. So I don't usually try to jump to his defense when he starts getting a lot of flack, because I think to think to myself, oh, he's probably earned that, yeah. So, but anyway, so that was an amazing game. So the one thing I had going for me when it was third quarter and I just didn't think they had a chance, and I remember my wife said to me, like, think of all the money we're going to save buying championship gear now. And so now, I mean, the one voice in the back of my, Well, you don't even know. When the Red Sox won in 2013, I got stupid.
Okay.
I mean, we're talking multiple hoodies, multiple T-shirts. It was not pretty. And it was somewhere in the neighborhood of like $400 to $500.
Ugh.
Yeah. No, because in your head you're like, well, who knows when they're gonna win another championship again? So I didn't go that crazy in the 14-15 season when the Patriots won the Super Bowl because I didn't. I bought like a couple of things and I said, all right, now I'm done. I can't go nuts. So I think I bought a T-shirt and a Christmas ornament that year, and that was it.
Craig, you don't even spend that much on movies and video games combined. But
nope, nope.
Red Sox?
That's it is a weakness I have. It is something, man. I am enthusiastic about, hence I can bring it on the show.
Ah, yes.
Oh yeah. So anyway, I know what I'm getting this time because I could use a new Patriots hoodie, so I might as well just get one that says Super Bowl champs. And the coffee mug I've been using at work is a 2013 Red Sox one, so I think I can get a new one of those. And then I usually get a Christmas ornament and a Christmas stocking just for Christmas time.
Just deck it all out.
Yeah, and that's fresh on my mind because my Christmas stuff is still up right now, I should probably mention. I have not even remotely had time. No. I don't. That is a delicate operation that cannot be done in the presence of a 3-year-old. So that makes it very tricky because, you know, not only is the 3-year-old have to be completely out of the equation, but then it's also turned into a one individual job because the other individual is with the infant. So
gotcha.
So that it just hasn't really happened yet.
Well, good luck when you finally get it down.
Yeah, the goal was going to be by Valentine's Day, but I don't even think I'm going to hit that. Honestly, I think now the goal is before March, before spring is my goal. I need to have it down before springtime.
Wow, I think John Wick will have come and gone by the time you get your Christmas tree down. John Wick 2.
Yeah. So, but anyway, enough about football because I don't think my core audience cares an awful lot about what I think about football. And those who do care about football, statistically speaking, probably aren't happy with the team that just won the Super Bowl. So, moving on from that, what the Super Bowl did bring us was a ton of commercials.
Ah, yes, the cornerstone of any Super Bowl, because nobody watches the Super Bowl for the actual game. They tune in for the commercials.
Well, that's not true. When the Patriots play, I watch for the game. But when they're not playing, yeah, I don't care about the football. I'm not one of those people who's like, oh, but it's good football. No, don't care. Don't care. If it's not my team, I'm just watching for the commercials. If you want to say that makes me a homer or a Fairweather fan, whatever. I don't care. I know what I'm about.
It's okay. It's okay. You have your morals and your standards.
Yeah, I know where I'm at. But no, some big previews. How about that Logan trailer?
So I missed the Logan trailer and was unfortunate enough to catch the Transformers trailer, which is no different than the teaser that they released a couple of days ago. And they're like, watch the Super Bowl for the extended trailer, and nothing happened that was different.
It was these Transformers movies, I if you were to like take a 2-minute clip of one of those movies and you don't include any of the humans, it's just, you know, the random robot crap, and mm-hmm. say, which one did this come from, I wouldn't be able to tell you. Like, if you show me Shia LaBeouf or Matt Wahlberg, I can probably kind of figure out or narrow it down. But you exclude the human characters, I don't even know which movie it could have come from. They all look the same.
I'm sorry, New Englander. Did you just say Matt Wahlberg?
I said Mark Wahlberg, didn't I?
You totally said Matt.
Did I really? Whoops. No, see, I said Mark. See, that's the problem. You misheard me.
I got you. Good old Marky Mark.
Marky Mark. He was good in The Fighter.
You know, I never saw. I gotta see some movies.
You do gotta see some movies. Now, he was good in The Fighter, but I imagine he was probably awful in Transformers.
I actually liked him better than Shia LaBeouf. He's good. He's
well.
Good
at, I mean, that's the, a pretty low bar.
Well, that's the thing, is that he looks like he could be an action star and like run around, and he actually does some. He fights some robots himself, so he's more believable in Transformers 4 as a human action star than Shia LaBeouf just running around yelling Optimus and no,
yeah.
You know, so he's a lot better, and I know the bar is low, but you know he's definitely good. But yeah, they should hire the people that do the trailers for these Transformers movies to actually edit the movies, Now, the content of the movies is still going to be crappy, but at least it'll look great.
Yeah. I have a hard time bringing myself to watching these Transformers movies.
After seeing these trailers, I'm kind of swayed, but yeah. I've learned my lesson after number three.
Yeah. So, but anyway, going back to Logan. So, I mean, in terms of Logan, it's nothing that we really haven't seen before. I mean, everyone seemed to be crying a little bit. And the song they chose, because the thing now is when you have an action movie trailer, is you choose a really slow, very, like, ghostly theme to go over it. And a lot of times they like to take, like, a song that's usually fast and slow it down. But sometimes they'll just pick a traditionally slow song. But that's the thing now. That's what you do. For Logan, they picked Amazing Grace.
Really?
Yeah, and it just seemed... Listen, the Logan movie looks really good, but when I think of Wolverine and Logan and the X-Men, Amazing Grace just isn't what comes into my head.
You don't immediately get welled up with American pride?
No. It seemed like a really... It was a really odd choice. I mean, the movie itself looks good, and it's nothing that, again, I'm sure if you really picked it apart, somebody who was looking very, very closely and wasn't lamenting their team going out there and tossing bricks for the last half hour probably took away more of it than I did. But it just kind of looks like more of the same that we've seen from the trailers. You get to see a whole lot of Wolverine, and you get to see some of Professor X and some of X-23, but I don't know. It didn't give me any more insight into the movie than I already had.
You know what? I do remember I left the room because I was making my own personal hot wings. But I came back and
how'd they turn out? How'd they go?
Oh, fantastic!
What do you use for sauce?
Butter, hot sauce, salt and pepper, and garlic powder.
Ooh, what? Yeah. What hot sauce? What's your brand?
I don't have a brand. Hot sauce is hot sauce.
Whoa!
And I realize now that I just pissed off half the internet.
Yeah.
Right. I want to say, you know what, I can't even yeah. You know, finagle this because I don't know any hot sauce brands.
No, so you got, I am loyal to my hot sauce, and I very recently, within the last 2 weeks, I made the conversion. This was a huge household deal. I made the conversion from Texas Pete to Red Hot.
Red Hot, that's one. There you go.
Yeah. And I think, because I tried Red Hot, and I thought to myself, I think I like this better than Texas Pete. So after 14 years of loyalty to Texas Pete, we are now a Red Hot household.
Okay. No say from the other members of the household?
Nobody else eats hot sauce but me, so I get to just make that call all by my lonesome. But I like Red Hot. You know what I use in my wing sauce, just a little bit of flavor, is a 7-Up.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Do they even sell that anymore?
Oh yeah, you can buy 7-Up. You can use Sprite.
Where?
At a store. It's just a soda, dude. You can get it from a machine.
I get Sprites more than 7-Ups, and I haven't seen 7-Up in years.
It's still out there. I have some in my garage. Would you like a 7-Up?
You know what? I think you should protect that, because I'm not sure how much longer it's going to be around.
Well, it's not like Ecto Cooler where they stopped making it, and I got to wait for like the next 7-Up movie or something.
All right, I believe you in that you have some and that it exists somewhere in the world. I have to now look for it because I couldn't find it anywhere.
I promise you, it's a thing. It's in every store. You're not paying attention because you apparently like Sprite.
Actually, I like ginger ale.
Well, that's just weird. I don't know what to say to that.
Well, fine. We'll move on from there because I'm just a weird guy. All right.
So anyway, I totally interrupted your story about the Logan trailer and leaving the room.
Unbelievable. Logan, yes, I left to do my hot wing thing, finishing off those wings and everything like that. And I came back and Logan's just running through a forest and his wife beater, his claws are out and everything. He's dodging trees and everything. So that was pretty much all I caught.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was the trailer was mostly that.
Just him being badass.
Yeah, him. And then he was crying, too. There was one part where he was crying. Professor X was crying, I think, at one point. X-23 might have cried. I don't know. It just seemed like there was a lot of crying. And some dude with a detachable hand. I don't know who that was. I don't know.
Yeah, I can't put a finger on who that is.
Yeah. Did you see the preview for the new Pirates of the Caribbean?
Ooh, I did catch that, and I'm not excited.
Really? I was excited. Now, I was trying to piece together. Now, for the background story, can I do a little inside baseball here on Hero Talk for the listeners?
We've already done football. Why not?
Yeah. So anyway, so I was going to do a hero talk on Pirates of the Caribbean. I had seen it. Jeff and Jen had seen it. We had set up the recording date, and then days before we were going to record, Johnny Depp went through this nasty divorce, and a lot of bad stuff came out about him. And I said, I cannot record a hero talk on this guy. But now this movie's coming out, so now I think, well, do I just never do hero talks on Johnny Depp movies anymore? Because
I think the heat is past, so yeah, it's okay now.
If you don't do hero talks on any actor who's done something that I find reprehensible, there's no more hero talk. Like, you gotta shutter the doors. Like, there isn't.
So the Pirates trailer.
So the Pirates trailer though looked good. I'm pretty sure I saw Orlando Bloom in it.
Yeah, there was a quick glimpse of him.
Yeah, and I saw Captain Barbosa.
Yeah.
So I mean,
it's looking weird.
Well, didn't he end up like merging with the? Forgive me, I'm about to call her Miss Cleo, but I really think her name was Cleo in the movie, but I can't remember. And I know Miss Cleo was the one in the psychic hotline, but
yes, $1.99 a minute.
Yeah, but I swear the character's name was Cleo or Calypso. Sorry,
Calypso.
Wow.
There we go.
All right.
I was gonna go with Cleo because I
was
remember.
Blanking, and I'm like, it's something like that, but I know that's wrong because I know Miss Cleo was on the psychic hotline person. Yeah, so Calypso, and they were together, but I it's been so long since I've seen At World's End that I don't even remember what happened, other than I vaguely remember that Orlando Bloom's character, Will Turner, ended up taking a Davy Jones place on the ship, and that he had to like go with them for 10 years, but then he gets to come back at some point, and I don't know if he's...
Every 10 years he gets to come back to land. So, like, in the end credit scene, they show him 10 years later coming back, and he has a son and everything, so I'm assuming that, you know, it might focus a little bit on the son, with glimpses of Davy Jones, Orlando Bloom, coming back.
Right.
But I didn't see Stranger Tides, so I'm not sure how much this is connected to that. But in the trailer, I did like the I guess the whatever pirate guys that are running on water or something like that.
Yeah, that looked pretty cool. I didn't see Stranger Tides either, so I imagine I should probably see it because generally I do like these movies, you know, Johnny Depp generally. Notwithstanding. I mean, I really really liked Black Pearl. I should say that.
Yeah.
And then
the first one, and then it was downhill.
The second one, I don't even remember what it was called. So obviously not a huge impression, but there were certain scenes in that one that I really thought were well done. And I believe that one featured the fight where Elizabeth Swann, Keira Knightley's character, and then the two other pirate guys were trying to fight off all these other people. But between the three of them, they only had two swords. So they had to be constantly tossing a sword to the one who needed it. And then as soon as he got done needing the sword, he had to toss it to the next person. And I thought that was, I mean, I don't care if something's realistic as long as it's fun and I haven't seen it before. And that was fun and I'd never seen it before.
Yeah. You know what? I don't remember that.
I believe that happened at the same time there was that big three-way sword fight on the water wheel that kept rolling all over the place.
Oh, you know what? I remember that a little bit more than
Yeah, everyone remembers that one because that was so stupid that people forget that there was actually another side action scene happening that was pretty fun.
All right. Well, yeah. I gotta rewatch the pirate movies then.
Yeah. Some of them must be on Netflix at this point, right?
Probably. I'll do a little bit of a search.
Yeah, I haven't checked. I know the first one, it was, at least the last time I watched it, and I have it on DVD too, but I don't think I bought any of the other ones. At World's End was kind of, I mean, it had Chow Yun-Fat in it, and I like Chow Yun-Fat, so I mean, just sure. that right there gives it a plus in my book.
Yeah. I do admit that I was very confused by At World's End because I wasn't sure who was double-crossing who by the end of it. There were so many side deals and double crosses that I wasn't sure whose side anyone was on at that point.
Yeah, that's pretty spot on, actually. That's pretty accurate. I had no clue what was going on in that one. I really didn't. Even from the very setup when they're at this place and they're talking to Chow Yun-Fat, and I can't, to this day, I couldn't tell you why they were there. I don't know if I just didn't really care enough because I just wanted to see more fun fight scenes and I didn't quite see enough for my personal taste, but, you know, whatever.
Oh, I do remember what Will Turner being mad at Elizabeth Swann for kissing Jack Sparrow, but she never explained to him why she did that.
Well, it sounded pretty bad if she said, I did it so I could force him to go down with the ship.
I mean,
it's
better
Kraken.
than staying quiet. It's like Spider-Man, where the butler doesn't tell Harry that
Or like
the glider...
Arrow and Flash and Supergirl and Legends, where everybody's got their secret that they're not telling everybody.
Everybody's lying to each other.
Those people have the most dysfunctional sense of ethics. It's all about, like, you can't let them know. And all right, so you can get away with that for, like, the first season of Arrow and maybe the first season of Flash. But Arrow's in its fifth season now. At this point, when somebody says, okay, but Thea can never know, Oliver's just got to step and say, like, that has never worked out at all. That has always come back and bitten us again.
They do make references to the fact that they're always lying to each other, but then they go right back to lying.
Yeah, they immediately go back to lying. They never learn. They say they do. They're like, I'm so sorry that I lied, and I swore I wouldn't do it again, and I don't ever want to have secrets, but this was really important. And then by the time they forgive him, he starts lying again.
So what you're saying is, by season 5, which I have not started watching yet, Diggle, who perhaps is 100% responsible for a major character death, is still involved with all the lying?
I'm trying to think just how involved he is with the lying, but no, now that I think about it, yeah, no, he's involved with lying, yeah. Yeah. Everybody lies. But whatever, as long as Diggle stays on that show, he is my favorite character on Arrow.
Are they still doing the Green Lantern thing with him?
I don't think they are. I mean, I don't know how far you've gotten, but he has his own code name now.
I'm up to the end of season 4. I've finished everything that's on Netflix.
So have you heard his code name yet? Have they established it? Spartan?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's really, I don't like his outfit. I get what you're saying.
No, I don't. And they changed the helmet a little bit and it's still not good. And I don't know. What I don't like is I just finished watching like the big 4-part crossover.
Yeah.
And I say 4-part lightly because Supergirl was basically just an episode of Supergirl where the Flash shows up at the very end in the last 2 minutes. That was the crossover.
Oh, man.
So 4-night crossover was being awfully generous.
Oh, man.
And then they rehashed that scene in the Flash the next night. So honestly, it didn't even have to happen in Supergirl.
That's unfortunate. I'm powering through all these shows and I have to get through Legends of Tomorrow.
On that Netflix. One's painful. I do not like that. I only watch that show because it ties into Flash and Arrow.
Yeah, and like I don't care about any of the side characters that they pull from Flash and Arrow. So like I like Captain Cold, but he's better on the Flash as sort of like kind of helping him, but kind of after his own things. And I liked him on that show, but here with. I don't care that the Hawk Girl and Hawk Man are on there. Like,
yeah, no, I got you. I actually like Firestorm, and very specifically, I like the Jefferson Jackson version of Firestorm because I never really read Ronnie Raymond Firestorm, but I started Firestorm when I actually started reading it month to month. I was reading it when it was the Jefferson Jackson, so that's the version of the character that I like.
Oh,
but
cool.
I got really excited when they introduced that version of the character. I'm like, oh, great. I don't have to deal with Ronnie Raymond. I get this guy. This is the guy I like. And it seems like in every episode of Legends of Tomorrow, they come up with some contrived way why Professor Stein and Jax need to be in different places.
So they can't fuse?
So they can't fuse and become fired. Like, you notice that? It's always like, well, you should stay with the ship, and we'll bring Professor Stein with us.
You know what? I'm only up to the third episode, and they've done that at least once. Where, like, where Jefferson is like, they told him to stay back, and, you know, Professor Stein is, like, you know, off doing something else. And I'm like, why?
I mean, even if you think, it's so silly. Because why would you not have him there? He is by far the most powerful person on that team. And it's not even by a close margin. And
well,
they go,
the Atom, you know, he's got that suit.
Yeah, but you need to see the Firestorm in the comics. He has some, like, he is massively powered, and they start introducing some of those powers as Legends goes on.
Oh, okay.
And then they still are like, all right, so Jax, you stay with the ship, and we'll bring Professor Stein. And Jax is getting mad, and I'm watching going, I'm in your corner here, Jax. I agree. You're getting screwed over by this. Why aren't they bringing you?
I mean, especially since they went through all the trouble to drug him to get him to go on the ship.
He forgives that way too readily. That is a big deal.
I am now back in the past because you drugged me. I didn't even want to go on this trip.
I mean, that is...
Oh my
The
God.
fact that they could even defend that position at all is it's very scary to me.
Oh my God, I have to, you know what? I had to stop it and just like push through Supergirl, and now I'm back to Legends of Tomorrow. It's actually a 2017 goal of mine is to just catch up on the Arrowverse, everything that's on Netflix, and then, you know, once the other season 5 of Arrow, season 3 of Flash, once those come out, I'll then catch up on those, but it's going to be a slog to get through Legends of Tomorrow. So. I hear it gets really good cuz the Legion of Doom is on it with like with Eobard Thawne and Damian Dark and Malcolm Merlin.
I haven't even gotten to that point yet. All I knew about was Dark and Thawne, so I don't know.
Yeah, apparently they're working together now, and I love the idea of that because I love all those characters.
Oh, yeah. But getting back to my original point, so Spartan always has his little handgun, which they never really establish. Is he killing people? Are those rubber bullets? I don't...
They established, I think in one episode, that they're stun darts.
Oh, they're stun darts?
Yeah, they don't... He doesn't kill. They're either rubber bullets or they're stun darts. They're like, you know, they're sleeping... They have sleeping agents
in them. Yeah, I could see him using one or the other, you know, but... But there's no way Diggle doesn't have a round of live ammo, or like, at least a magazine of live ammo with him.
He probably does, if he needs it.
Because he's Diggle, you know? But what got me is you have this huge team-up, right? And everyone's together, and then they're going to, you know, together to fight this other grand enemy. So huge that they had to bring Supergirl from another universe in to help them fight.
Yeah.
And Dig is still just tooling around with his little pistol. You don't want to get, like, a M16 or something? Or maybe something with a little more firepower, Dig? No? Your pistol?
No.
You're good on that?
That's not part of his ensemble costume.
That just always kind of struck me as odd, and when they were showing the group shots and the fighting. And then the idea that at the end of the day, the people who... It was just the Flash and Supergirl took him down. Not to spoil it, because it's just kind of... You have to read between the lines. Because they give you all the action scenes, and then when it's all said and done, when you really stop and think about what you just saw, you have to think, I don't think anyone else was necessary. I think they really could have gotten away with just Flash and Supergirl.
Oh, man. That team-up really sounded like it was going to be... Ugh, damn it.
Now, there were some scenes in the middle of it that were really good, and they utilized the team. But it was in the final one. There was a whole lot of stuff going on, and then if you read, like I said, you got to read between the lines, and then you'll think I don't think anybody else was necessary.
Yeah.
But anyway, I'll leave that to you to watch and to figure out for yourself.
I'll catch up, and then I'll send you a message about how furious I am.
You're gonna send me a message. I'm gonna get it one day, and you're gonna be like, yeah, that was dumb.
As I've been doing up to this point,
as
like,
you've
they're
done
still
every
lying to each other. Why are they still lying to each other?
I love getting the messages from you. Like, why are they still lying to each other? Do they ever get better at this?
Oh my God! Just I'm glad that Supergirl's now on it, but she's not even on the same Earth. I just found that out the other day.
Yeah. Oh, you saw the Supergirl Flash crossover?
Well, I saw the crossover. I finished Supergirl season one.
Okay.
But like, even when they bring her into the quote unquote Arrowverse, she's still on a different Earth. So it's not like Flashpoint did anything to merge their Earths together, which that's what I thought they were gonna do.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know,
I thought they were going to do that, too. However, I think, and you'll see, I think what they ended up doing works for what they want to do. So we'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
I don't want to go into that too much more. And, you know, because no need to spoil it for you, because you'll get there. You'll figure it
I'll
out.
I'll get there.
Let's see. What else did we see during the Super Bowl? I saw I said Legends of Tomorrow. Not them. Guardians of the Galaxy.
I missed it.
It was pretty cool to see all the new people. Baby Groot is looking to be my favorite character in that movie already.
Of course.
Yeah, I love Baby Groot. Did you see this? I don't think this was in the commercial for the Super Bowl, but I think they released it a couple days ago. That conversation between Rocket and Groot, like telling him not to push the red button.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
as the father of a toddler, I have had that conversation before. Now don't touch it, all right? You can't touch it. Got it? Okay. Say, okay, daddy. Okay, daddy. So, all right, fine. No, don't touch it!
So I touch it, right?
Yeah. Because in her head, she just heard blah, 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 touch it, blah, 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 blah. Okay?
Especially if it's a shiny red button.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Yeah, I can't think of any other major previews. I know But it was...
shout out to Jen, Stranger Things Season 2.
Oh, Stranger Things Season 2. It didn't resonate with me because I didn't really like Stranger Things. As you'll hear in the hero talk when I do eventually release it, I just recorded it 3 months ago. I don't... I got
a lot
busy.
Of things have happened,
there
folks.
Were babies.
Don't worry
I was
it.
Dealing with stuff. But yeah, so... but yeah, they did preview that, so we get to see Elle. So we knew she was coming back, but we get to see her. And there's Eggos. Everyone likes Eggos.
Ah, yes, and Ghostbusters.
And Ghostbusters. Just to remind you that it was set in the '80s.
It's all just coming together now.
Yeah.
But yeah, I did enjoy that. That and it's coming out in Halloween. So
yeah,
super excited.
So that. By Halloween, I might actually be able to start watching shows again.
Woohoo!
Right now, a lot of what I've been watching has been reruns of stuff I've already seen, because I can't give it the utmost attention, because I'm usually watching while an infant is screaming literally into my ear.
I mean, I don't blame you.
Yeah, so I can't watch anything that needs my full attention, because it just isn't going to get it. So it's been a lot of... I rewatched all of Scrubs... I rewatched Parks and Rec. I've been going through Burn Notice again.
Oh, of course, of course. Good things to go through.
Yeah, all good shows to go through. I forgot how good Burn Notice Season 6 was. I think a lot of people dog it because they thought it was getting a little stretched in the premise, but I watched it again. I actually liked it quite a bit.
You know, that's another show that I got to about episode 3, and I just couldn't continue.
Oh, that's too bad.
Maybe I'll give it another shot, because you rant and rave about it.
I love me some Burn Notice. Especially season 2 of... Even if you don't want to watch all 7 seasons, if you just watch season 1 and season 2...
Okay.
And then even if you just end it after season 2, you will see some of the best television, in my opinion.
That's a bold claim.
Season 2 of Burn Notice was... At the time, Burn Notice was my favorite show, and very well may still be. But season 2 was so good, and each episode was better and better. So at any given point in time, the episode I just watched was the best episode I'd ever seen.
Mm.
I really enjoyed it. And season 2 was easily the best season of Burn Notice.
Okay.
So it gets good, but I mean that was the peak with season 2, and then it goes down, then it comes up a little, then it goes down, then it comes up a little, then it goes right in the toilet for the last season. But season 2 season 2 was the best season of that show. That's the one to watch.
All right, when I finish Legends of Tomorrow, which I'm not looking forward to, I'll get back to Burn Notice.
Oh, Legends. That's they play fast and loose with the rules of time travel. The Flash does too, more or less, but with the Legends, it's things like, we changed the past, but you don't feel it yet because reasons.
We're in a pocket dimension that where no one can hurt us.
Yeah, or the way Reverse Flash can still be running around even after.
Yeah, I don't get that.
They tried to explain it, and...
He's trapped in the Speed Force?
Yeah, he was... Because he was in the transmit, then he still exists. I don't know. They really just need to, like, look in the screen, break the fourth wall, and say, can y'all just please believe this so we can move on?
Look, we don't understand what we're talking about. You don't understand what we're talking about. Let's just have some fun, okay?
Yeah. We can spend the next 20 minutes on scientific, theoretical technobabble. Or you can watch Barry run. It's your
run,
call.
Barry, run.
Run. They say that over and over again.
I just downloaded a ringtone where Harrison Wells is saying that. Just run, Barry, run. I can't have it as my alarm because it's too low, but still.
That's funny. All right. Anything else you want to shout out to in terms of Super Bowl talk?
The T-Mobile 50 Shades of Grey commercial.
Those were weird.
Those were weird.
Extremely weird. Especially the one that was the worst for me was where she calls the Verizon hotline. She says, I went over on my charges. Are you going to punish me?
What are you going to do to me?
Yeah. And they're like, well, there's going to be additional costs plus, you know, fees and taxes. She's like, oh, say that part again. Oh. And I should just say, as I have literally, within the last day, come back to Verizon, I went out, I explored the field, and I decided, you know what, I'd like Verizon better. So I went back to Verizon and got a new phone.
Hmm.
And that whole overage fee thing, you know, you can shut that thing off so it doesn't just automatically charge you overages on your data.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it'll do, it does the same stuff that my old phone used to do, is it just, when you hit your data limit, it throttles you down to 2G, so you still have mobile data, but it's just not 4G fast anymore.
Oh, okay.
Which, you know, if you're smart about your data, then I don't come really super close to my limit ever, and then it rolls over to the next month, so if I don't really ever come close, and then I have a nice margin of, you know, a few gig, those few gig will roll over to the next month, and then I have, you know, I definitely won't come close, so.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I don't know. If you're getting those kind of overages, then you're, I don't know if you're going to the gym and just streaming movies. I mean, you know, you can download movies on Netflix now and watch them later. You don't have to stream movies. I don't know what you're doing.
Oh my God, I didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
No.
Oh, that's brand new functionality, my friend.
Wow, okay, oh, yeah. Well, you're teaching me all kinds of stuff about phones.
Yeah.
And technology.
Yeah, so that's huge that you can do that, because for plane rides and stuff like that, and car rides, that's a big deal. You know?
You can download and then watch them without having to, like, log in to Netflix.
I believe you can watch them offline, and I haven't read up on it. Amazon Prime does a similar deal, and it's just, you have 30 days between logins to Amazon to watch it, and if you haven't logged in within those 30 days, then you won't be able to watch it anymore. But as long as you've logged in the last 30 days, you can watch it offline.
Okay, I'll give it a shot.
Yeah, it helps me out. I use it for car trips and stuff when I gotta put something on in the back seat to keep people entertained.
Fair enough, all right.
Yeah, all right. So I think that's all I got for the Super Bowl, unless it's still your soapbox. You can talk about anything you want that you remember from the game.
Let's see. There's a Buick commercial where a bunch of kids are playing football, and then one of them miraculously turns into an actual NFL player and starts, like, knocking kids over. And, like, he throws the ball, and it blasts the kid back so that he hits a touchdown. And so that was pretty funny. Other than that, no, I'm gonna watch this Mass Effect Andromeda multiplayer gameplay.
Ooh, you know what? This is Mass Effect is we've talked about it offline so much that this is gonna sound like old hat to you, but it doesn't come up on Hero Talk an awful lot. But that's the thing about Mass Effect is I want to like it. You know, like, it has all the elements of something I like, but invariably in the second one and more so in the third one, they've done something, or they've taken the lore in directions, or they've taken shortcuts that just become increasingly more and more frustrating for me, to the point where in Mass Effect 3, the frustration almost overcame the fun factor. In fact, it did, I believe, overcome the fun factor on the game. Now, I still played some of the DLC. I didn't play all of it, but, you know, so it's not like I didn't ever want to play Mass Effect again. But I wish Mass Effect was a person, and I could grab that person by the shoulders and say, I want to like you, why do you push me away?
Well, look, I mean, if they had taken the risk and just made Andromeda into its own series, like, ditch the Mass Effect, because immediately once you make another Mass Effect game, it's going to have the stink of the previous games on it, so make a new franchise. Like, it's, like, you have all of the elements here to basically just say, yeah, humans destroy their world. Like, you know, those environmental movie messages where, like, it's kind of like Firefly, where they drain the world of its natural resources and they went off into space. So it could be something like that. You don't have to tie it to Mass Effect. It's not necessary.
Yeah, from what I've been able to tell, the ties to Mass Effect are pretty loose, other than the fact that they brought a lot of species that we would recognize, and there's probably reference to events we would recognize and some technology we'd recognize. I mean, the things that happened in the Mass Effect series don't seem to really have much of a bearing on this movie at all, or this game at all.
God forbid they make a movie.
Yeah. So, I don't know. I would like to like it, but I really need to wait for some of the other Enthusiacs to play it and let me know. And then I need to wait for myself to have enough free time to play it.
Well, here's to hoping they come out with a beta soon.
Yeah, but I'm sure the multiplayer is going to be fun. In Mass Effect 3, the multiplayer was a lot of fun. I played a lot of that with my friends.
Oh, yeah. So, but other than that, I've got nothing else for the Super Bowl.
All right, and neither do I. So Hey, thanks everyone for a quasi-mini episode. Actually got quite a bit of content in there. But thanks everyone for listening in. If you want to check out more content, including podcasts, Let's Plays, articles, check out Enthusiacs.com. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. Just search for Enthusiacs. And until next time, this is Judge Greg saying, 5-time Super Bowl champions, your New England Patriots. All right, bye everybody.